And we're live.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another very special episode of Fans of Power. With me, as always, is partner in crime, Joe Amato. Joe, how are you?
Oh, I'm ecstatic. I'm just so excited about doing this again and talking with William Stout and finding out more things. It's like, Sunday couldn't get here quick enough from last week with the unfortunate thing that happened and with the audio and video. And I was like, oh, God, we need for this to happen. So, yeah, I'm super, super excited.
Cool. Yes, and as Joe mentioned, Mr. William Stout has graced us with his presence again to give us this much-anticipated sequel to his first discussion. So, Bill, thank you for joining us again.
Hey, happy to join you guys.
Awesome. I know we're definitely felt like I know we had a good long talk after we lost the last week's episode of how crushed we were because we were just so. I told you, I was like, I feel like a sad puppy right now. I can't calm down from this right now. I just wanted to crawl up and just do nothing. So it took a little while to get over that, but we got it here. It was well worth the wait. So we're ready to go when you are.
Did anything from last week get out on the air or on the net?
Just like it just happened to go up. What we did do, and actually it was viewed like 40 some times, even though it wasn't a full episode. And you know, people were just they were asking. You know, yeah, we're still going to do it. We're locked down, so he's coming back. So we're all good to go. People have been asking about it.
Well, cool. So, well, let's see. So should we begin where we left off on the very first thing with the big downer?
I guess, yeah.
Why not? Let's go ahead and start with the downer. Why not for people who haven't seen the
– There you go. Okay. So the picture I'm about to show you is my design for Robbie's Ribs and Chicken. Let me make sure it's centered.
Looks perfect.
There we go. So we took a real place in Lakeview Terrace. It was a real fast food place. And then I did this design. And basically, we built plugs to go in and cover the actual signage of the real place and to turn it into Robbie's Ribs and Chicken. It was called Robbie's because it was named after Robert Howland, my art director. And I wanted it to be as all-American as possible, so hence the red, white, and blue color scheme. And it's ribs and chicken. What's more American than that? Now, the historical significance of this place, though, the actual place is right in front of it. That's where Rodney King was beaten in the famous video.
Oh, dear God.
A really bizarre, arcane bit of Masters of the Universe trivia.
That's a horrible thing you definitely don't want to put together, but wow. Yeah, that's a downer. I mean, it's
certainly typically not something that's linked to Master of the Universe in any shape or form, something like that.
No, not at all.
Wow.
It's pretty bizarre, a bizarre coincidence.
It was, I guess at the time, was that set when, were, I guess the set was torn down or was it used for anything else once you guys were done filming there?
Oh, once we were done, we took off the plugs and repainted the place and restored it back to its original fast food identity.
Okay, so you guys took an already established fast food restaurant and just kind of built around. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay,
got it. Yeah, to save money, we took an existing place and I just redesigned the exteriors of it, but basically gave it a new skin.
Did it need much of a new redesign? I mean, like how much different was it from, you know, the before and after, would you say? Was it quite different?
Well, the building was the same, obviously, but all the colors were different. The signage was different. Obviously, it wasn't really called Robbie's Ribs and Chicken.
Okay. Do you remember what it was called by chance? Or?
No, I don't.
Oh, okay. Well, all right, that's no problem. Yeah. I was curious. Thought it'd be a cool little factoid. Well, it looks great. I mean, that design was great. So, yeah, yes. I've never seen it drawn like that, but I can only imagine.
Is that something that I guess obviously you have the final say because it looked pretty much what we see in the movie. At least I didn't see any, you know, drastic differences from it. Is pretty much.
Oh yeah, My crew's job is to follow my designs.
Okay, so it's not like you have somebody on the set is kind of arguing with you about it or anything like that. It's what Stout says is what goes.
No, my word is law.
There you go. Right. He is the law. I am the law.
Yeah. So to lighten things up, though, we
okay.
This fella here.
look at him. Now, what are fans, I mean, for the ones that aren't seeing this, what is this exactly again?
Here's what this is. I kept getting lists from Mattel of the characters that needed to be in the film and everything and their commentary on them. And they kept sending me this one character named Cosmicky. And I'm going, who the hell is Cosmicky? I looked at the script. I couldn't find Cosmicky in any of the script names or the character names. And I'm thinking, what in the hell? And so I drew what I thought Cosmicky might look like, and that's this drawing here.
And it was supposed to be the Cosmic Key, huh?
Eventually, I figured it out. They were referring to the Cosmic Key, but they spelled it all as one word. So
Cosmic Key.
I can see the confusion there, and you certainly gave him what, you know, it definitely sounded like it was supposed to be.
Yeah. So
I love it. I've never heard that. That's got to be the greatest thing ever.
It was just one of those little wacky things that happened on the set. Now, the actual
reaction to that?
What was their reaction to that?
Yeah, I mean, did you show that to them in the
well, of course they did.
They must have cracked up. Well, that.
I think that's probably when they got back to me and saying, "Oh, actually, we meant the Cosmic Key, not Cosmicky."
Fantastic! Oh my! Oh, I'm glad you shared that. That's hilarious. I've never seen that before. I feel like making Cosmicky now. No.
So the real Cosmicky was actually designed by Ed Eyth. EYTH, fantastic designer. Ed is really skilled in doing tech stuff, and that's one of my weak spots. I don't really feel that that's a strength of mine. So whenever anything really techy was called for, I assigned that to Ed, and he always did a great job.
Did the Cosmic Key go through a lot of different interpretations? I'm sure that's probably what Tyler was probably just going to say too. If the Cosmic
Actually, Boss Film was hoping it would. The very first meeting I had with Mark Stetson from Boss Film, it was to determine what stuff was going to stay in the film, what stuff was going to be out, what stuff would they have leeway as far as design goes. And unfortunately, the first thing they brought up was the Cosmic Key. And they said, you know, this is really complex. This is going to be very expensive. It's going to be really difficult to make it do all these things. And I said, well, sorry, guys. I'm sorry this is the first thing you brought up, but it's got to look exactly like this, and it's got to do everything we say. And they were really pissed off. They were pretty bummed by that. But unfortunately, that was just the first thing they brought it up. I mean, there were other things like I could have given a little slack or leeway, but this was the key prop of the film, so it had to function and look just as great as Ed had designed it.
Now, was that something that kind of got passed? I mean, was that like, was there any discussions about can we make it different, or was that that was the final look, like no discussion? Everybody was like, you know what, that works, or?
As far as I was concerned, that was the final look, no discussion. Boss Film, they tried to say, well, what if we left out this or we didn't do this? And I said, nope, I'm sorry. This is it. It's got to look exactly like this, and it's got to do everything that is called for. So
now did you have any kind of description as to what it does? Like, because obviously when it opens up, you have the small spindles all spinning, you know, as around. Is that something that you had input on, or is that?
That was not a detailed description. I just let Ed go. I said, Ed, this is our number one prop. Do your best and make it really special. And he did. He did a fantastic job.
Did they? It looked amazing. It still looks amazing. It's something most fans would all love to have, like a movie replica prop that they could set up in their collector's room or something like that, the Cosmic Key. It is
especially
a beautiful
function like that with all the spinning bits and everything. That'd be so cool. I'd like to have one.
It'd be awesome. Music too. You hit a button and it plays a tune, you know, it'd be awesome. It'd be fantastic. I'd pay $200 for that.
Now, here's an obscure bit of Masters trivia, is that I auditioned for the part of the guy in the music shop.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You were going to play Charlie?
Yep.
What happened with that? Wow. But
after that, I was horrible.
How can they turn you down?
I did an awful audition. It was really – they got the right guy, believe me.
Oh, how could it have been that bad? You being the music guru that you are, you know, I figured that would just flow naturally. And
that's how I got the chance. And Victoria Thomas, our casting director, she was open enough to let me at least, do a reading with who was it? Was it Robbie McIntosh, the boy who finds it?
Robert
Duncan McNeil. So I got to, that's who I got to do my reading with. It was great. He immediately started improvising, which completely threw me for a loop because I spent, you know, weeks memorizing my dialogue, and suddenly that was just thrown out the window. I was like, I don't have to handle it now. Right. I've had a lot more experience with acting and stuff, but boy, back then it was Bill, keep your day job.
Did you at least try like an Alfred Hitchcock thing where maybe you were just in the background walking past or do something? Did you ever think about that or no?
I did that in Return of the Living Dead. I'm the bum on the sidewalk that the punks step over towards the beginning of the film.
I got to go and look for that then. I got to go look at that.
Oh, that would be cool.
Yeah.
That was a weird day.
It was seen with James Tolkien, you know, having an interaction with him, you know, Detective Lewis. That would have been great to see you with him. It would have been definitely a very completely different look, because I just can't imagine you playing the Charlie character the way that he's portrayed in the movie. I just see that now I'm just gonna be wondering what that could have been like every time I watch.
Well, my Charlie was more of a stoned hippie type of guy,
yeah,
who's also at the same time trying to con Robbie into giving me the machine, the instrument.
It would have been even crazier. Could you imagine if you would have did like a cameo as one of those trooper designs that you hated, and you turned against another trooper to start shooting them?
Yeah.
Can't stand these designs. No.
Well, speaking of the troops, because I was curious about this, was it just the initial kind of standard infantry troops that was the design you didn't like, or what about the warlords or the air centurions? Did you have any?
Oh, I thought those guys were fine. It's just the what we call the stormtrooper, because they looked identical to the stormtroopers in Star Wars, except that they were black instead of white.
Right.
But the warlords were, I thought, you know, as a kid, it was just kind of fun to see. You got the cape and the laser rifle there with the blade at the end. I can't remember the technical name for it. That's like on the old fashioned rifles and things like that. But that was such an amazing design, and they look so imposing, and the air centurions too. Did you design the hover disc too that they ride around on too? That was
Ed Eyth. He designed the hover disc, and he designed the uniforms of those guys too.
Okay,
gotcha. So like you said, he did pretty much most of the techie type stuff then.
Yep.
Okay. Well, there's a question that Joe wanted to hold specifically to ask you. Then I think he knows which one I'm talking about, which is, you know what I'm talking about, Joe?
You know what? I was so flustered from last week when we didn't get to do it. I mean, which one was that? Because I have a lot in my head, but go. Let's see if
This was something that people had asked us about, too, after the first interview, was She-Ra.
Oh, yeah, sure. That's what I was going to ask. Yes, She-Ra. I mean, were you really pushing hard to get her into into the movie? Were you disappointed she wasn't in there? I mean, like, how did that all go? Because we've seen your design that you did of her, and just how did that all fall into place?
Well, She-Ra was in the original script, and so that's why I designed her costume, because she was, for all, it was intended that she was going to be in the film, but when they started cutting major chunks of Eternia, they also cut her out too.
Just so completely.
Is She-Ra in Eternia? Let's see if I can get this here.
Oh, that's her, huh?
Yeah.
I've never seen. Oh, wow. Never seen that before. Look at that. What a shame. Now, was she going to be, like you said, she was obviously going to be in the movie, but was it a pivotal role? Was it just like a slight part, or was she really going to have a main part with her brother, He-Man?
It was as large a part as Teela was.
Wow, that's a pretty good size then.
Wow, yeah. What a shame. And so did you, like how the last time we did, we did this and you explained you had a nice bio and background. Was there any specific type of unique bio or background that you wrote up for She-Ra?
No.
Oh, nothing different for her, just pretty much He-Man's sister? No.
Before I could do that, they cut her from the film. So
there's
no point in doing it after that.
Oh, that is unfortunate.
Now, how close to filming was it when she was cut? Like, the time frame before are the sets being built, is it all pre-production, or is it pretty much last minute, or is it way in advance, or since she was such a pivotal part in the script?
It was during pre-production, and it was probably about probably about, I'd say, 2-3 months before shooting. She
wow,
got
that close.
Well, so she hadn't even been cast. So.
Oh, so there was no costume design, nothing made for her at all, nothing. That actually physical costume design, nothing was.
Yeah, I did the costume design, but no, it never got built.
Not got built. Okay, okay. That's unfortunate. Yeah, because fans have always, you know, wondered what happened and why was she, you know, why she wasn't in the movie. And yeah, I guess that's very interesting and very unfortunate as well.
Huh. Yeah, I wanted her to be really hot and be every bit as strong as He-Man. And
oh, as she should be. Yeah, exactly, exactly. And
did you have anybody in mind back then of who you, when you're designing this, did you have an actress that you had seen before when you're doing the design? Or
no, if you look at the design, it's just a generic beautiful woman, blonde, big head of curly hair.
We're talking like big 80s hair, because I'm a big fan of women with big 80s hair. I love that look.
It wasn't a mullet, but she would look hot.
Oh boy, would she have? Oh Lord.
Unfortunately. Well, Tyler, go ahead. Hit a question before he hits us with another amazing piece of art, or are you hitting us with some art right now?
Here's another piece of art. This is Doors to the Caverns of Snake Mountain. And it's gigantic doors. Let's see here.
Yes, oh Jesus, yeah, that is gigantic. Are there people standing in front there? I can't.
Yeah, little tiny people.
Well, that does definitely show the size of the doors to Snake Mountain.
Yeah, major scale. So we probably would have built the area directly around the actors, and then the rest of it would have been a match shot or a hanging miniature.
And was that, again, Snake Mountain was probably cut because of what? Money issues, time issues? But oh, okay.
Yep. Budget.
Wow. What could have been? I mean, the movie's still fantastic, but my God, to have all the extra stuff that you showed just makes us cry a little bit inside.
Yeah, it would have been fun. So this next picture is Skeletor's dining hall inside the tower room. Sort of an Art Deco kind of look.
Okay.
I like that window with the moonlight shining through there.
Man, all these pieces. That's another amazing one.
Gotta that's eat. A very beautiful gothic look for Snake Mountain, too. And it fits Skeletor's look. Like, I could picture him and his outfit sitting, you know, in that dining hall. It fits so perfectly.
Well, I wanted to design each domain so that whether or not you knew where you were in the story, as soon as you saw it, you knew, oh, this is definitely Skeletor. This is definitely He-Man. I wanted each place to have its own distinctive feeling and mood and look and color scheme. Here's another one. This is Skeletor attempts to escape. Originally, at the end of the film, he does try to escape before he confronts He-Man. And this is my interpretation of that.
Wow. Let's see what that is. Now, is that like some kind of like pod, or what is that again exactly?
So let me see here. So this part here, this is like part of the castle.
Okay.
And there's a sort of a bridge leading up to get inside the castle.
Mm-hmm.
And it's rain slicked, and he's running across it trying to escape.
Oh, there. Now I see. Okay. At the first angle, I thought there was a castle, but I see. Oh, so there would have been something quite different instead of the, like, you know, ending that you, like you said, because of, you know, how the movie had to be kind of wrapped up quick, and you had to make that quick ending of just throwing them down a shaft.
Yep.
So we would have gotten like a drawbridge battle with He-Man and Skeletor probably with that scene set up, correct?
Yep.
Oh man, gosh.
Okay. Now, this one I know. Yeah, I think this is one of your favorites. This is one of my preliminary designs for the matte painting for the Castle Grayskull exterior.
Yes. Oh, I absolutely that is my absolute favorite. I just love. What now? I know you said you're a Wizard of Oz fan. Was this intentionally, you know, to have like a touch of the Emerald City with that?
It was probably done more subconsciously. It's in a way, it's sort of a cross between the Emerald City and what it is like to stand on a hill in Los Angeles and look down into the LA Basin.
Gotcha. Oh, so cool.
It's like he's just reaching into a magical bag of goodies, and I keep wanting to see what is he going to grab next.
Oh, and I want to see this stuff in animated features and movies. Like, all this stuff is still it's so damn good. And it's like, I still want to see every bit of the stuff used.
And like you said, you are having a book that you're planning on putting out of all your concepts and sketches and everything, correct?
For all my films, yeah.
Oh, man.
Sign me up.
Yeah, we did left. Actually do. Did either of you guys see the thing on Jodorowsky's Doom, the documentary on the ill-fated?
No, I didn't see that.
Because they made a huge, gigantic book of all the designs that Mobius and Giger and Chris Foss and other designers had done. I would just kill to get a copy of that book. It's incredible. Well, we did something similar for Masters of the Universe. I printed 12 copies of a book, which is all of every single design I did for the entire film. It's a pretty thick book. And 12 copies, I gave one to the director, one to the producer. I kept a couple. Anyway, that would be a nice book.
Oh, man, we have to make sure you get that done.
Oh, yeah, if you put this out, people will buy it. But what do we have now?
Okay. This is Skeletor, Karg, some of his heavy-duty bodyguards, and a few people walking through corridors where there are gigantic pillars, and it's the light coming through the pillars is sending these big shafts of light across the floor.
Oh, that's awesome.
I love it. You know, just William, I there's another thing that I know fans would go nuts for, besides obviously buying the book, that when you put it out, trust me, the word will be spread around and all Masters fans will get it. But we eat up posters, just those, almost like how you're holding as big as air. I guarantee you, if you were able to even get those into some printed forms of any size posters, they buy it in droves. It's guaranteed. We love art. Masters fans, we love art as much as we love the mythology of Masters. So is that something you ever thought about, giving posters, like even after a book, doing a posters or something like that?
Well, you know, there was an Art of Masters of the Universe book, and it's got an interview with me in the book, and I was ready and willing to supply all of this stuff for the book. And then Mattel said, well, if we print it in the book, then we own it. And I said, well, I'm not going to give up my copyrights for free. You know,
no,
that sounds like,
trust me. Yeah. If you do it under your own terms or something, trust me. And it's all yours. I mean, people still, yeah, they'll definitely buy it. So yeah, if there's a way you could do that, trust me, we'll help spread the word. And I guarantee people buy posters or books.
Mm-hmm. Well, see what
I want to see what you have now. It's like, good God.
Here's another Castle Grayskull exterior. Let's
see this one here. That's a good one too.
I like that one.
I like that one a lot.
Now this one was
there.
I'm a big fan of a period of art called the Symbolist painters. It was around 1900, and there was these group of painters. They did stuff that had mythological themes or fantastic themes and stuff. And one of the most famous paintings of that genre was a painting by Arnold Berkeland called Isle of the Dead. One of his Isle of the Dead paintings at the Metropolitan Museum in New York, I believe. And that image was so popular, he painted at least 7 versions of it. And so this was inspired by that.
Okay. You know, I have a question about, you know, obviously these different designs of Castle Grayskull. How did you guys come on a final decision of, you know, obviously the one that you used for that, you know, kind of like intro? Is there, I mean, was that your final decision, or did they decide we like this Castle Grayskull?
Ultimately, that was up to Gary Goddard, the director. Gary made the final choice because I gave him a lot of variety of, okay, Grayskull could look like this or like this or like this or like this. Which do you like the best? And then he chose.
Okay. Because that one you just showed, it kind of had a familiar vibe, if you will, at least to me, of Castle Grayskull.
Okay, here's
Now, that one, oh my God, this might be my favorite so far. I don't know about you, Tyler. I'm enjoying this. I'm liking this look. Wow. All right.
I like this one a lot, too. And, I was going to point out, It's got to be really hard to see on your screen, but right up here inside the socket,
I see her.
The sorceress.
Sorceress. Yes. That's even cooler. Were you?
What's the initial inspiration for that?
Here's kind of a zoom so you can see it better.
Oh, yeah.
And you can definitely see that there's somebody in there. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, did you wish there was a different final one that was used for the movie, or did you, you know, like you said, Gary chose the one he did? I mean, did you prefer any of the others that you were shown so far, or?
Yeah, I like the ones, well, like the one I just showed. It was just a lot more dramatic and more detailed.
Yeah, that's so far my favorite. I don't know if you have more of them, but that's my favorite so far.
Okay, so one day, we're in the middle of shooting the movie, and I can't remember if it was the producer or somebody came over and said, okay, so where's the costume for the contest winner? And I'm going, contest winner? What are you talking about? They said, oh, Mattel, you didn't hear, Mattel had a big contest, Masters of the Universe contest, and the winner gets to be in the movie. And I said, well, would have been nice if we had been told about this. so I could prepare something or plan something. And they said, well, the kid who won it, he's here right now, and he needs to be in the movie. And I'm like, oh, really? That's like no notice whatsoever. So it took me about 15, 20 minutes, and I did this design, which later got colloquially called Pig Boy. His actual name was Mata Shai. And I did this design about 15, 20 minutes, immediately color Xeroxed it, gave copies to Michael Westmore, the makeup guy, and also to Julie Weiss, the costume designer. And within a couple hours, they had the makeup and the costume and everything all set for this kid. And
that is amazing.
This is the design.
Look at that. That wait, so you just drew that up that quickly, and they made it that quickly just within hours. Is that what you say? Oh, God, I'm mind blown. That's insane. You know, because it's funny. Look at that. Yeah, that's cool. What's amazing to see, that's the thing. I remember, you know, it's a shame, you're right, they didn't inform you, because I remember going to the stores, and around the He-Man toy aisle, there was those little mail-in forms, and it said, mail it in, and you could be in the movie. And of course, never made it in the movie, but it's weird. So they wouldn't even tell you, and they had all that promotional material. That's kind of bizarre. It really is.
It's weird. Well, at the time, Mattel was very, very, very disorganized.
Wow, that's unfortunate. That's unfortunate.
Is that due to, because we've, you know, and obviously they showed up on set and told you about their kind of financial problems they were going through. Is that part of what was going on, or why it was so disorganized, or were they
I'm not sure if that was just the nature of the company at that time, or if people have been coming and going and leaving, and you know, when that happens, there's always confusion as the old regime disappears, the new regime arrives. There's a lot of stuff that needs to be sorted out, and it's confused. So, but actually, I don't know what it was. I just knew that not the most organized company in the world at that time. I'm sure they're much better now.
How far would you say into, you know, the shooting of the movie did you guys get the feeling something was maybe going to start going downhill, to where possibly you knew maybe the budget wasn't going to be able to cover a lot of things? I mean, was it just bam, just slammed on you? You know, like, oh, the movie's not going to be able to get finished. You know how you guys got, you know, obviously how they shut it down on you. But, I mean, did you guys have a hint of something was just not right?
I sure didn't.
Oh,
no, you know, I'm the eternal optimist. So for me, hey, everything's going great. I was up on budget, on schedule with everything. So I was a really happy guy. So I didn't realize that Canon was going through this gigantic death struggle at the time.
I guess at what point of production is are you guys in when you get word from Canon and Mattel's got to come in and fit the rest of the bill and all this chaos of the staffs get ready to walk and. Just, I mean, is there a certain point of production that you can remember, like, oh, boy.
Well, it was an interesting chain of events because, you know, at one point after I'd been made production designer, at one point the Mattel people were walking through the offices of the art department, and they're going, oh, man, that's going to be a great toy. Oh, that's going to be a great toy. Oh, that character, that's going to be a great toy. And I stopped them. I said, gentlemen, you've hired me and my designers to design the motion picture, but you did not hire us to design your next year's toy line. If you think you're getting this stuff for free, we need to talk.
Okay.
And they just got this look of terror and horror in their faces. And they actually threatened to shut down the film 8 times.
Mattel did?
Yeah. They're trying to force us to sign contracts to give up all our rights to all these characters and designs. And we banded together and said, no, we refuse. If we're designing next year's toy line, then we get a cut of that because we don't design for free. And so they were really, really pissed. But yeah. Eventually we went out. I mean, I told my staff, I said, let's just keep working. We're still going to make the picture and everything, but we'll stand firm and steady on allowing them to make toys out of them unless we get paid.
So, I mean, I guess that would be the other question is, how did it come to where just Gwildor, Blade, and Sorod were the only ones that were made? Did you guys come to some agreement and that was the only three? Or how did that work to why they were the three that were chosen?
That was totally out of my hands. I just assumed those are the three that were chosen because they were not part of the line yet and they wanted to establish them as characters.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because I didn't know.
I've been curious why Karg, you know, is always, you know, it just seemed natural that he would have been a figure too. And, you know, was there no discussion as to why they didn't pick him? Or
those decisions were out of my hands. I was there to design the movie. And if they wanted to make toys out of all that stuff, great, as long as they paid us.
Did you, do you happen to remember or still have some of the designs that they were looking at when they were thinking like they want that as a toy, they want that as a toy?
Oh, I've got everything I did for the film.
So including all those illustrations that they were wanting to make toys out of.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. We need this book.
Yeah. So the other funny story, which you probably heard if you watched the Canon documentary, is that this was a joint production between Mattel and Canon Films. And I forget what the total budget was. I think it was probably around $37 million. And so Canon told Mattel, okay, you're responsible for half of it, and we're responsible for half. So you guys put up your half first. So they did. Mattel did. And when the money ran out, Mattel said, okay, it's time for you guys to put in your half of the budget. And Canon said, nah, we don't think so.
So just like that, they were we're not doing it.
So Mattel is like, oh my god, if we don't pony up the rest of the money, we're not going to have our film. And so Mattel had to come through with the rest of the budget because Canon refused. Canon didn't have the dough, but Mattel didn't know that.
Wow, and like you said, it still wasn't enough because then that, you know, that day came, that dreaded day where they just shut you guys down and wow.
Yeah.
Is that Manam and Yorn coming to set and shutting down production in front of everybody and telling you're done? Or is it somebody they sent down there? Or
I wasn't on the set that day, so that's a question you have to ask Gary.
Okay. But did you have a whole lot of dealings with them when you know while you're doing your job? Like, did you
with talk Mattel? With them at all?
Yorm and Globus.
Oh, with Menachem and Yorm? They were very accessible. Yeah. I tell you, one of the most bizarre things that has ever happened to me on a film happened to me on Masters of the Universe. We were in the middle of production. We were shooting the movie, and I got a call from Menachem's office. We need you at a meeting on Sunday at noon. And I'm already going, Sunday? Man, nobody works on Sunday. This must be really serious if they need to see me on Sunday. Wow. So I had no idea what it was about. So I show up Sunday at Canon Films, and Elliot Schick, the line producer, is there. Gary Goddard, the director, is there. And they've got three seats facing – I think the guy we were talking to was Ronnie Yakov, the number three man at Canon. And Ronnie's facing us. I'm sitting in the center chair. Elliot is to my left. Gary is to my right. And Ronnie proceeds to ream Gary for what he's been doing on the film. And then as his eyes cross over to Elliot, they stop on me, and he gives me a big grin and a smile. And then he continues, and he looks over at Elliot, and he reams Elliot. And then he looks back at me and gives me a big smile, and then he reams Gary again, looks at me, gives me a big smile, reams Elliot again. And I'm really uncomfortable because here's my two bosses being reamed right in front of me, and all I'm getting is a nice big grin from Ronnie. He's not saying anything to me other than smiling. And I think that was Canon's way of saying, hey, you're the only guy here that is on time, on schedule, and on budget. We're really happy with what you've been doing. The other two guys, we're pissed.
That's what I was going to say. It's like, wow, at least, I mean, yeah, you, I guess you didn't get yelled at, but they brought you in to give you a nice show, apparently.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. What a moment that must have been like.
The afternoon, man. That was, like, just so surreal.
Based on your own personal experience, because obviously Electric Boogaloo, everybody has their opinions of the duo. What is your, looking back at it as opposed to knowing them back then, what is your viewpoint on them? Are they as crazy and eccentric as everybody seems to paint them, or are they just misunderstood, or what is your, I guess, your viewpoint on them?
Oh, all of the above. These guys were crazy. But, you know, I really miss them. I wish Canon was still around today. I mean, it was an extraordinary company to work for. It fulfilled a real need in the film business. They were similar in some ways to Roger Corman, in that Roger Corman and Menachem at Canon, if you were a young filmmaker, you could get in to see these guys and pitch them and on the spot get a yes or a no. You didn't have to go through this whole chain of command like you do with the other big studios. If they thought it was a viable project and they said yes, you get your shot to make your film. Now, you wouldn't get much money. That was the deal going in. They were making low-budget films. There was no pretense that you were going to make a $60 million or $80 million film. There's no way. But you get your chance to make your movie. And so Roger Corman launched the careers of Martin Scorsese and Ronnie Howard and Jack Nicholson, so many people in the business, and myself included. He bought my first screenplay. And Menachem was the same. You could get a meeting with Menachem, and you get a yes or no on the spot. And if you got your yes, you got your shot to make your film. And there isn't an entity like that in the business today, allowing young filmmakers to have that, get that opportunity. So,
no, it's a shame, too, because that's – and it has such a big fan following because the movies were so – it was a vast variety of movies. Obviously, the documentary shows just how big a variety they gave people to. And of course, kids who grew up in the 80s were all raised on the Chuck Norris films and the Bandit films, the crazy fantasy films they did, too. So
yeah, Chuck Norris was the bread and butter. And I had a bizarre experience in that while Menachem – was here in LA, he decided he would direct again, and he directed another film. He directed Delta Force with Chuck Norris. And because he's the president of the company and he directed this film, they actually had a black tie opening for Delta Force. So, I was totally up for it. So I got dressed up in my tux, for a Chuck Norris film.
Norris action.
Oh, that's so cool.
See the film, they had it at one of the big Hollywood theaters. And then afterwards, everybody went to the an after party, which was at the Canon Film offices. And Canon Films had this huge building with five levels of parking. And on the five levels of parking, each level had a different restaurant. And they were making, free food for everybody who came. Top chefs and stuff. And the mayor of Los Angeles spoke at the thing. Because at that time, the most films in production by any of the major studios was Warner Brothers. They had six films in production. Canon had over 60 films in production. I've heard 86, actually. So, boy, they were generating a lot of dough in L.A., which is why Mayor Tom Bradley was there to, congratulate Menachem on directing Delta Force. But they were there for a while. They were a really powerful entity in L.A. in the film scene. And I miss those guys. Yeah, they were crazy, but they were also funny, and they were also really passionate about making movies. These were not accountants. These were not bean counters. These were guys who actually made films, and they were also producing them.
I guess at the same time, that Masters is going, are you guys aware of the other two big budget films that – over the top of Superman 4, are you guys thinking, is this not irrelevant to you guys, or just is it on the radar at all that, they're spending an awful lot of money on these other big projects? Are we going to have to worry about our budget too? Or
I wasn't aware of that. I mean, I was aware of those films being made because I was keeping track of all the different Canon projects that were going on. And I saw that they were starting to up the budgets. And that didn't worry me, but it should have, because they were not used to making anything other than low-budget films. And so when they started to venture into that higher-priced arena with Masters of the Universe and the Superman film and you know, giving Stallone all that money for the arm wrestling movie, you know, if I'd been smarter, I would have been aware that, uh-oh, something's going on.
Do you think this would have still worked if they had spaced these movies out a year apart as opposed to all released in the same year?
Yeah, I think it was an element of too much too soon.
Okay, I thought that too, because obviously Superman 4 speaks for itself with all the problems that went on with that too. But yeah. I feel like Masters was, you guys managed to, even if the budget was low, I certainly couldn't tell, and not until, and even to this day, I'm like, nothing looks cheap in the movie. Nothing looks like corners were cut. The suits, the sets, all the Earth stuff. I mean, here's something I want to ask you too. I assume you designed Gwildor's home? Yeah. Did you not?
Actually, most of Gwildor's hut, the interior, was designed by Joe Griffiths. He did a beautiful job. And what we did is we took technology from the Rose Parade floats, and after Joe had done his initial designs, we took chicken wire and sculpted it in the form of the way the interior of that hut was going to look, and then we shot it with this foam that when it dried it hardened like rock. And then, but you're still able to carve it if you needed to, and so that's why that set has such a nice organic feel to it.
It looked awesome.
I'm going to show you. Here's an early version of Gwildor.
Oh, I like that.
I do too.
So, yeah, I mean, this, were you picturing when you did this as being a little, like, more older and wiser or something?
The older, wiser wizard, you know, who's eccentric and absent-minded and is constantly inventing little things and stuff.
What is that little smoke piper? What's that coming out of his back? What is that? Is that little smokes and...
Yeah, he's got a little backpack. It's almost like a tank, and there's vapors and smokes coming out of that. I noticed he's holding the cosmic key.
Yeah, and it looks like it's the final design, it appears to be.
Yep.
Yeah, you said you weren't letting that design go, and thank God you didn't, because that's a fantastic design for that cosmic key. But, oh, wow, I've never seen that. God,
I like that touch of Gwildor's ear being bent down. That's a nice little touch you threw in there.
Yeah, I like to take... make little surprises or something symmetrical, and then you tweak it a little bit, like flop the ear. So, oh, gives a little more interest.
Yeah, I like that touch. That's really cool.
Wait, what they got next? Here we go.
Okay, this is all stuff that Tony Gardner, the great makeup artist, built for me. And these were all plants from Wildor's garden. You notice the stormtroopers, when they come up to the door, they trash that little garden that he's got out in front.
Quick little crazy question. Did he actually name all these unique plants because?
No. Okay. No. I just drew these up, colored them, and then Xeroxed it and gave a copy to Tony, and he started building all this stuff.
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
Because it looks spot on as to what you see in the movie. It's not in there very long, but it's pretty recognizable.
Well, now, one of the interesting things, I don't know how many people know about this, but we went through a number of location searches. At first, Eternia was going to be shot all in Iceland. Huh. And so they did a reconnaissance tour in Iceland. Unfortunately, I was not the production designer at that time. As soon as they got back, that's when Jeff quit and I was made production designer. So I missed out on the free trip to Iceland, which I would have loved. And which, you know, they ended up shooting tons of Game of Thrones in Iceland because it's such a phenomenal location. Mm-hmm. So I'm really sorry we didn't get to do that. So then they were thinking, okay, Iceland, that's going to be too expensive. How about Idaho, Craters of the Moon? And so I did go on that location scout. And there's actually a lava cave that we were going to shoot in. And here's the design I did for that.
Now,
this is an existing location. It's a big pile of lava, and then there's a hole in the roof and this is all lava back here. And so I was going to put a crashed spaceship on there.
Okay, now what was that going to, I guess this area, I mean in the spaceship, what was it going to pertain to, would you say? Any specific event in the movie or what?
I don't remember now.
Was that possibly going to be, because I know there's references that the, you know, He-Man's parents came from Earth, or mm-hmm. that there was another tie into Earth. Would that have been like the first ship from Earth to have crashed on Eternia there? Or
yeah, that works for me.
Okay. Hey, there you go. Tyler just wrote some history for Masters. There you go. Sure.
You should be writing screenplays, man.
You know, it's funny, he just quickly mentioned his parents. I didn't know if that was ever brought up. Was King Randor and Queen Marlena ever even thought of for the movie, or no?
No, not at all.
Not at all? Okay, so let them out. Just He-Man. Okay.
Okay, so here's a couple of my designs for the Skeletor Stormtroopers. The one in color is called, I call it the Elite Guard, and the big guy, I call him Mofo.
Mofo. That's a big badass.
Definitely can see why Bill would be upset for his designs not being used, because that Elite Guard is that's an ass kicker. Those are really cool looking.
Yeah, I thought it was a more interesting look than just knocking off Star Wars.
That is a different design. Yeah, definitely looks nothing like anything we've seen.
So here's an early version of the Grayskull throne room. After Skeletor has taken it over.
Oh, that's cool.
Yep, that's pretty spot on to what we know.
Yeah.
That, definitely, yeah. Glad that stayed, you know, that design.
Yeah.
What's he got next? He's got the gigantic bag of tricks.
Here we go. Here's an even earlier design of that same spot.
Here. That's nice.
What is that? Is that the throne, or is that
it's a big giant floating crystal.
Whoa.
And is that the Eye of Eternian back of it, obviously opened? Yeah. I think. Okay.
I wanted to ask you about the origin of the Eye of Eternia. Like mm-hmm. what is your story for designing that?
Well, I always liked it. I love the way camera lenses work, and actually that's what we use. We got a huge camera lens, and use that was our miniature. When you see it opening up, that's a real piece of mechanical equipment, because it would have been too expensive to actually design a sort of a spiral opening thing. I mean, if the technology is already there, why not use it?
That's okay, good. And I'm glad, Tyler, you just mentioned about the Eye of Eternia, because this is a question I've always had. I don't know if this is something, anything that you had to do with certain things being written, but mm-hmm. as we know, you know, when the Eye of Eternia, when it opens and Skeletor gets all the power and becomes, you know, God Skeletor, if you will. Yeah. Now, is this the same power that's within He-Man? You know, the same, or, I mean, I guess what I'm getting at is, you know, if the Eye of Eternia opened and He-Man got that power, would it have changed him, or is this the same power that He-Man has within him? I guess it's always had me question that part about the Eye of Eternia and that power.
I think it would have changed He-Man, because to me, in designing this place, my philosophy is that power is neither good nor evil. It's what you do with it. And okay. So let's see if I got So if you notice in the film, everything that's above ground level, they're what I call the space gods, those big giant sculptures. Right. And everything down below is like gargoyles and nastiness. So that's an indication of, yes, this is the seat of all power in the universe, and it's either good or bad depending upon how you use it. Skeletor is deciding to use it for bad, and so when he gets bathed into that thing, he says, "I am as a god." He's basically basking in an extension of his existing powers, which were bad. If He-Man had been caught by the same thing, he would have been made more powerful, but he would have stayed good. It wouldn't have changed his personality or his point of view or his direction of his life.
Now that's something I was very curious about that we briefly touched on last time. And obviously we get that one panning shot when Frank Langella comes into the front, and you see just how far down to the mat the panning extensions. All the is that your design? Like, with all this, there's so many stairways and levels in that one shot. To like when you kind of look down as he's kind of coming into the throne room. Is that that's all yours too? What we would have seen had they filmed that?
Yep.
Oh, man, it was so cool looking too. So to have seen all the sword fights and stuff like that, because the ups and downs and overs, all that stuff down there. It was just, I just love to pause and look at that scene of just all how much depth is in that. I've always been a big fan of matte paintings. Mm-hmm. You know, even in The Wizard of Oz, when you look in the background, you see all these beautiful mountains and landscapes, and like there's so much stuff back there. I want to know more about it. And it just leaves the so much to be desired of how much hard work was put into it and all the details and just so many things that you notice. And that's a testament to your work in designing all this stuff.
Well, thanks. Since I knew a big sword fight was going to happen there, I went back and I looked at, I have two big heroes as production designers. One is William Cameron Menzies. He was the first person to actually ever have the title of production designer, and that was for Gone with the Wind. And the other guy is Anton Grote. Anton Grote was the guy who designed all the Errol Flynn swashbucklers. So I went back and I watched all of Anton Grote's films, Captain Blood and the Seahawk and stuff, and I made notes because I wanted this to be the ultimate setting for a sword fight so that the actors would have all kinds of stuff to do, overs and unders and stuff they could swing on, stuff they could hide behind, steps that they could go up. And so that's what influenced the design of that set.
So that we would have seen it, like, because I know like certain moments in some of the Errol Flynn movies where they're fighting up a staircase and going down the staircase with, you know, broad swords and things like that. So that's kind of what we would have gotten probably had the sword fight been extended.
Yep, absolutely. Oh,
man.
Another interesting bit of Masters trivia is the inside of Julie's house is the inside of the house that was built for a Cary Grant movie called Mr. Blandings Builds His Dream House.
Whoa.
That house still exists, and it was on the Paramount Ranch, which was a movie ranch where they shot all kinds of stuff. It's where we shot the scene where they land in Earth, and they're in there's like a little pond or a lake puddle.
Yes,
that's all there, and that had been used and owned by Paramount for a long time. And some accountant at Paramount 1 year forgot to pay a certain fee. And so the entire place reverted back to Los Angeles County being the owner. So I was able to get that house for, I think it was like 10 bucks or 100 bucks, something like that. Unbelievably cheap for a location. The production was so happy with me.
I can imagine.
And I had also, I had used that house in the prior film I had done for Canon, which was Invaders from Mars. That was the Invaders from Mars house when we did the remake.
That's a cool tie-in.
But originally it was built for a Cary Grant movie.
Hmm. Very, very cool. Tying back to the throne, because this is something I've had this conversation with Joe or somebody else too about the hieroglyphics that you put in the Grayskull throne.
Oh, sure.
I always thought that was such a speak of the devil, right?
That's
there.
Freaky. And could you describe, like, you know, what we're looking at again, just so it'll pop up on big
screen? Okay, so this is the throne. It's the seat of power to all the universe. And it is ancient. No one knows who built it, when it was built. It was millions of years old. And it's a combination of this interesting sort of brown stone and iron, lots of iron that is been set into the stone, and you can see the iron is rusted over the years and parts of it are dripping, but this is where you want to go if you want to rule the universe.
I guess so, that's the thing with, you know, again with that and the Eye of Grayskull, obviously that's why the sorcerers. Now, did you ever have ideas of, you know, if they were going to try to go in more deeper mythology of other guardians before the sorceress that have protected that Eye of Eternia? Because I'm seeing that now as, you know, your guys' version of the power of Grayskull, which He-Man and the sorceress protect. I mean, was there other ideas of guardians for that place too?
If there were, they didn't tell me. I was just I just went by the screenplay that was handed to me.
Yeah, you
were mentioning the lettering. One of the things I like about this design is it is a combination of sort of ancient and high tech. I used computer circuit boards as my design jumping off point for some of the stuff that's in here. But also there's lettering, there's ancient lettering. And I designed an entire alphabet for this culture. Whenever my guys needed to do something from Eternia, they already had that stuff to pull from. They could just use the letters that I designed for the alphabet and then plug them into the designs.
Designing the alphabet. That's a fascinating thing that you just dropped on us here.
Yeah, because I was going to say that. I was like, were these hieroglyphics something that you just took from other cultures? But now that you said you made that, that's absolutely bananas that you made a whole entire alphabet. You're going to have to – I'm telling you, when this book comes out and people get it, you got to put all these details about the hieroglyphics, the bios behind the characters, all that, because us fans can geek out and, you know, write to each other in your special Eternian language.
Okay. Oh, now this one was one of my favorite sets. The problem we had is we needed a set for the communications room, but we had very little money. I can't remember what the budget was, but I thought, wow, that's almost no money at all. So how am I going to solve this problem? Because I want to have a cool set. And so I thought, I know, I'll design basically a one wall set, but I'll bend in like a quarter of the left and bend in a quarter of the right. And so it looked like you're glimpsing at a room that's sort of hexagonal or octagonal in shape. So that's this design here.
That's spot on.
Also, the thing is, this screen here, we were going to do a rear projection on this screen and showing was when Skeletor is zooming in through the universe and going down to planet Earth, going down to California to zoom in on where He-Man currently was on Earth. And the problem was that behind the screen, there wasn't enough throw behind it to do a rear projection, because right behind that screen, just 3 feet from it is a wall. So I designed it like this so that we could shoot from high above. The actors could work down in here without breaking the screen, and you could front project it, which is what we did. And then I designed it so carefully that nothing extra was built, and they had to use the lens that I chose to shoot it with, which is a 50 millimeter lens, because I knew that would give me the exact look that I wanted. And so
that's spot on what's in the movie. I mean, regardless of budget, that's exactly what we see.
Really close. And then we wanted these machines here too. Well, obviously we didn't have enough money to build one of these machines. So I took an existing crane, a camera crane, and then just designed a shell that fit around it. So all the mechanics were already in place and we didn't have to worry about that. We just needed to build the skin that fit around this thing.
That's beautiful. That is so cool.
Yeah, it did work perfect. Definitely worked perfect. Now, did you have ideas? Oh, wait, go ahead. I'd like to see your next thing, and then I'll ask you a question.
Oh, next thing? Okay. Yeah. This one we called Chunko Town. And that's when a whole section of Earth comes to Eternia.
Yes.
This is when we cut the Cadillac in half. And
I love these pictures, and I love that scene. Yeah. That was always one of my favorite scenes. You know, it was just always so cool because, you know, not only, you know, seeing them get back to Eternia, but I remember as a kid, I felt so happy in a way for Lubick. Meaning not that, eventually he stays there, but the thought of, because Lubick through the whole movie is wondering what is going on.
Yeah.
And just seeing parts of Earth now on Eternia and his reaction, I love that. And I'm so glad you did that for the movie. That just worked so perfect.
Yeah, it was fun. That part was fun. Okay, I got one more here. I've got tons more at my studio, but I just brought, about a dozen pieces.
Just a taste of a future.
This is Eternia Throne Room Celebration. And this is even though it says Throne Room, it's actually an exterior scene, and it's a gigantic celebration on Eternia after He-Man has triumphed over Skeletor. And there is a throne, but it's sitting outside. But I'll show you this. There,
that's cool. Very, very beautiful.
Now, that would have been cool to see the celebration outside. The celebration inside, don't get me wrong, is still fantastic, but you had to see a little lush.
Yeah, we got huge lavish fountains. I had huge fountains in here, lots of lush greenery with tons of flowers, flower petals floating through the air, big, wow, huge banners and ribbons and stuff. Here is the throne with the big disc behind it.
Mm-hmm. Another beautiful piece. Jesus.
And well, you still got part of your studio?
So, oh yeah, I did over 100 designs for the film. So, yeah, so I got the rest of my studio. I just picked a bunch of stuff that I thought you guys might not have seen or I thought were interesting.
Well, we definitely find all that stuff interesting. And, you know, to, I guess, elaborate more on a possible book, I mean, is this something that you definitely are going to do? Is this just, you know, an idea? Is there, you know, like...
It's definitely a book I want to do. A lot of people have asked me to write an autobiography, and that's a little too overwhelming. So my thought was, I know, I'm going to do a whole series of books. It's going to be a multi-volume autobiography, and each book will be on a different aspect of my career. So the first volume has already come out. That's all about my murals, my mural work, and what I was doing in my life while I was painting these murals and how those came about. I'm going to do one on that's all my music-related art. I'm going to do a book that's all my film designs. I'm going to do another book that's all my entertainment advertising designs, my movie posters and stuff. And so each book will focus on a different time of my life. And in the text of the book, I'll talk about what was going on in my life at the time, and peppered throughout will be all the designs I was creating.
And do you have, is there time frames of like each book, like, you know, every 6 months, every year, couple years? I guess the reason I'm saying is, I know Masters fans would look forward to this. And again, you would have no trouble at all having this sell, because the fandom is just starving and biting for anything Masters right now, because, you know, there's not much things that exist that's new. So to get something like what you would provide, which would not only be concepts we've seen before, but also new ones and in very good details and color, but especially you adding, if like you said, even adding bios and backgrounds to every character, like you know,
funny stories too.
I'm saying this would just be insane. I mean, so do you know when fans could possibly have an idea? You know, because we'll spread the word. Me and Tyler will spread this like a virus.
Absolutely.
As soon as it looks like it's going to become a reality, I'll get in touch with you guys and let you know. I've got books in the pipeline coming out before that. I'm working on a big sort of overall career book for Inside Editions. And then I've my regular publisher, John Flesk, he wants to do a book collecting all the comic art that I've done. And I think that one is... that's coming close to completion. One book that is almost ready to go now is all my music-related stuff. So that's all my album covers, CD covers, band posters, band flyers, stuff like that.
Okay. And did you say you have a book out already, did you say? I have
the book on my murals. That's the first volume. That's okay. Out.
All right. So that's still available.
It's called William Stout Prehistoric Life Murals. You can buy it on my website. You can buy it through Amazon, whatever.
And is your website williamstout.com, I assume?
That's it. Yep, williamstout.com. And if you buy it from me, then you get a drawing in the book.
Okay.
Oh, that's awesome.
All right. Well, I think me and Tyler might have to go to your website.
Well, I already have. I've already beat you to it. I've already purchased from his website already. So.
Oh, you bought that mural? Jesus, I know.
I bought a book to his tribute to Willis O'Brien.
Yeah, it got sent to you a couple days ago.
Yes, yeah, I got notification about that, so I'm very excited to check that out, because I know that description of the giant insect scene, and that's in the description. So that was something I was very interested to hear.
That's a big chunk of that book. I really did my homework with that. We're talking about the spider pit sequence, which is one of the greatest lost pieces of film ever made. And in when Peter Jackson redid it, you know, he did his own version of it. It's available as an extra on the King Kong Blu-ray and DVD. But he found five creatures that he thought definitely were in that sequence. And I expanded it. I found 24 different creatures that were considered to be in the spider pit sequence. And I did illustrations for each of those. So that's in the Willis O'Brien book.
Oh, awesome. I can't wait. I just can't wait to dig into that book. It's so much. Do you do interpretations of the dinosaurs and everything as well?
Oh, sure. Yep.
So,
in fact, right now I'm in the middle of doing volume 2, which will have Giant Behemoth, Black Scorpion, Mighty Joe Young.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
I have to get that too.
Yeah. I'll have that done ready by March 1st because we're going to have a show honoring Willis O'Brien at Creature Features in Burbank, California.
Are they going to be you doing like a panel or anything like that? Or
We haven't done the final plans yet. We're going to have an art show, which will consist of all these different local artists' interpretations of O'Brien's creatures, probably a lot of Kong pieces. And at the same time, a really good friend of mine, Frank Dietz, he's finished this incredible documentary on the influence that King Kong has had on filmmakers. It's called Long Live the King, and I'm all through that, and it's a fantastic documentary. It just won an award at a film festival for best documentary. It's just great, and it's really funny, too. It's really entertaining. Some of the people he interviewed are comedians, and one of my favorite scenes is there's a comedian being interviewed, and they show a clip of right after Kong has been gas bombed on the beach by Carl Denham. Carl Denham is talking to his crew. He says, "We're going to be rich, boys. I'm going to share it with all of you." And then it cuts to the comedian. He says, "You know, I can sort of believe a lost island full of prehistoric animals and dinosaurs. I can believe a 50-foot gorilla. But hey, a producer that's going to share, I'm sorry, I draw the line there. That is pure fiction."
Oh, that should have been in the movie too. Oh, that's so cool.
So I'm really looking forward to that documentary coming out on DVD.
Is there information about that? I would love to hear more about
that. Yeah, just Google "Long Live the King."
Okay, Long Live.
That's the name of the Kong documentary, and you can probably see clips of it on YouTube or on Facebook.
I'll check that out tonight.
Yeah.
I guess Joe, how are we doing time wise here? Because we don't know if we're keeping you from anything.
Oh no, I mean I'm hearing a weird echo for some reason.
Huh.
Is anybody else hearing that or no? Okay, there it stopped. No, yeah, we just been about an hour and 8 minutes into it. Yeah, because we definitely didn't want to hold you up for too long. But no, I mean if there was any,
I got so many more questions I wanted to ask him too.
Man,
do I ask you to come back another time to do more discussions? Because I still got, you know, all these questions here.
Okay.
I still didn't even get to ask. Well,
let's do that, and I'll bring some more pieces of art too to share that you guys haven't seen. So,
well, I definitely know I'm going to williamstout.com to order some stuff because Tyler was holding out on me. He wasn't telling me I didn't know about this, and I find out that Tyler's already
this really cool. I forgot the name of it, and I'm hoping I love to have it. It came from the depths, or it's
Up from the depths.
Yes. I love giant, you know, giant creatures eating people posters. I've always, ever since I was a kid, seeing them in video stores, like the artwork was so fascinating.
Oh, and wait a second.
I love that poster. It's I want to have it hanging up next to my Jaws poster. I got it all.
Wait, I just got a question now. Wait, I mean, you have posters on your website as well?
Oh, yeah.
Oh God! I'm telling you, you got to do those Masters ones. Everything you just showed, I'm telling you, you put those posters, they will sell. I'm gonna be in line just to get whatever the heck you put up. I don't care. I'm getting them. We love wall posters. You got to.
I was to do that, then I would have to work out a deal with Mattel, because I can't just start manufacturing Masters of the Universe stuff and selling it. They own that. Now I can in the context of a book, I can put all this stuff in a book. There's different rules for that. That's not considered exploitation. The book is considered by the United States government as a benefit to the public, so it falls under different rules. Which is why I did my blues book. It's called Legends of the Blues. It's 100 portraits of my favorite blues musicians born prior to 1920. And originally I did it as trading cards until I was informed by the guy who did Robert Crumb's music trading cards. That No, that's considered commercial exploitation. So I would have to get permission from each of the people that I had drawn to do that. But he suggested doing a book, which does not fall under those things.
Okay, well, I guess that could be, I mean, double goodness, because, you know, once you do the book, which obviously people would buy after the book, then do you think that could be a possibility of doing any deals with Mattel to make posters? Is that a possibility?
Yeah, if Mattel plays nice.
I think they will. I mean, really, I think they would play nice. I mean, because especially, like I said, with the fans of wanting anything that comes out, mm-hmm. I'd hope. You know, that's me being optimistic. You said how you're optimistic. That's what always Tyler says about me. I try to be optimistic all the time. So, well, Tyler, I didn't know if you had any final questions for him or.
Yeah. Because I told Bill earlier. And I had learned this a little while back that he is attached to the property Diner Riders as consultant. And I'm just curious because that was a cartoon and toy line I loved as a kid. And I just was curious about your part of that development. You know, was that doing concepts or making sure, because you're such a dinosaur fan. So I didn't know if it was maybe following, you know, certain looks for the dinosaurs or, you know, what your part of that was.
I hate to disappoint you. It's a pretty short story. Basically, Diner Riders called me up and they wanted to hire me as their paleontological expert on the series, which is fine. That's great. I don't mind doing that at all. And basically, what they really wanted is they wanted to have my name at the end of the show so that if any educational sources or if they got any flack about, hey, this not being an educational show, they can say, no, look, we had a paleontological expert on the series. Now, initially, I took the job very seriously, and I would go through their stories and their scripts and their designs and just basically correct it for factual stuff. Like, you know, you said this dinosaur is from the Cretaceous, it's actually from the Jurassic, so you just need to change that one word of dialogue. They didn't want to hear any of that. They wanted me to leave them alone and just let my name go on the show so that if they got any flack that the series was not educational at all, they could point to my name and say, hey, no, we had an expert dinosaur guy on this. And so.
Oh, wow. I was thinking you had done designs of the T-Rex with lasers on them and stuff.
That's
like
what
that.
I was wondering.
No. Now, I was more involved with another series called Dink the Little Dinosaur because for that one, I designed what are called bumpers. Before it would go to a commercial, it would go to a bumper, and it would be like we call it Factosaurus, and it would be a little true fact about a particular dinosaur that was in that show, and I would illustrate it and design it, and that they would show one of those right before each commercial break.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Well, I guess speaking of little dinosaurs, you illustrated the little blue brontosaurus. Is that correct?
Right. Yeah, won the Children's Choice Award for 1984 as Best Children's Book.
Which inevitably led to The Land Before Time.
Well, yeah, that's where The Land Before Time came from.
Did you have any kind of input or work on the film, like, because of the book? Because I looked at some of your illustrations, and they look fairly close, you know, to
close. It's lawsuit close. That's how close it was. Here's what happened. I was working for Conan the Barbarian, designing stuff along with Ron Cobb for that film. And when we started there, we had this really bright receptionist. And after about 2 weeks of my being on the show, she got a major promotion, and she became John Milius, our director, his personal assistant. And about 2 months after that, she became Steven Spielberg's personal assistant. And about 2 years after that, she produced E.T. That was Kathleen Kennedy. And I got contacted by Jim Henson's daughter, Lisa Henson. Because Lisa, she wanted to do either a film or a miniseries on this epic fight between these two paleontologists, Cope and Marsh. Between these two guys, they discovered about 1,200 of the known dinosaurs. And she was trying to talk her father into producing it. And her father, Jim Henson, he was looking for his next what he called realistic Muppets film. He had done Dark Crystal, he had done Labyrinth, and he was looking for his third project, which with the more realistic design. And so he said, hey, how about if I do a Muppets dinosaur film? And then we developed the technology in that that we can later use for your Cope and Marsh movie. And so she thought that was a great idea. So they were vacationing, I think it was in the Bahamas, and they were looking at all these different dinosaur books for inspiration. And their cook was delivering their lunch to them on the beach, and she looked at what they were looking at, and she said, huh, you think those are dinosaur books? I'll show you a dinosaur book. And she went back to the house, and she brought them out a copy of my book, The Dinosaurs, A Fantastic New View of a Lost Era. And they were looking through it, and it blew their minds. And then on the last page, there's my bio, and it in my bio, it states I've been working in film. And they're like, wow, not only does this guy know dinosaurs, but he's already made movies. You don't have to explain anything to him. And so Lisa promised Jim Henson, her dad, that when she got back to L.A., she would call me and ask me about working on this film. And so I got the call. It sounded great. And so I had a meeting with both Lisa and Jim. And at the basically the result of the meeting was, wouldn't it be really cool to do a great dinosaur movie? So we had another meeting a couple weeks later, and this same thing resulted. And I thought, boy, if I don't do something, get this project moving, it's not going to do anything. So between then and the following meeting, I wrote a screenplay for the dinosaur film and brought it to them. They got real excited. They showed it to Warner Brothers. Warner Brothers gave us a big budget for the movie, including $5 million, which at that time was a lot of dough for just our research on doing Muppet dinosaurs. So I began designing the film. And about that time, Henson found out that Spielberg and Lucas were making The Land Before Time. And a friend of mine was visiting Kathleen Kennedy, who was the producer on that film, and he saw that she had my book, The Little Blue Brontosaurus, sitting on her desk. And that's when I knew, hey, something's amiss here. And they claimed that they could get their film done a year before ours, which what turned out not to be true. But because of that, Jim Henson didn't want to look like he was knocking off Spielberg or Lucas, so he canceled the project.
Oh.
Ironically, of course, I got hired to do some of the advertising for The Land Before Time, sort of rubbing my nose in it.
Oh, and, Lord.
But then it was about a year or two later, I was working at Walt Disney Imagineering, designing theme parks for them. And Jim Henson was walking down the hall. He saw me in a meeting. He pulled me out of the meeting. He says, Bill, I've got great news. Our dinosaur project is back on. We're going to make it. And it's really going to be fantastic. And I will call you next week. And the following week is when he died.
Oh, Jesus.
Gosh.
So I'll never know what that meant, what turn of events had happened that he was reinterested in the dinosaur project again.
What a Jesus. I mean, to start off this podcast with a kind of sad event and then to end with a sad event. It's like, well, wow.
Say, I had no idea it was going in that direction.
Okay, Tyler, just
welcome make, to Mr. Gloom and Doom.
Make him say something happy before we have to sign off until next time when he comes back. Hey, you got a good
One of the greatest things about making Masters of the Universe was every day I'd be on set, and in the morning I'd feel this little tug on my coat, and I'd turn around, and it'd be Billy Barty, you know, the guy who plays Goldar.
Yeah.
He'd have a new joke for me every single day.
Was there a particular joke that you remember that he said maybe that was a really doozy?
I'm really bad at remembering jokes, but it was so sweet. He would search me out. He'd find me, and he'd tell me a new joke every morning. It was just a great way to start the day.
I like that. No, that's a good
That's a good memory of Billy.
Yeah,
he was cool. You know, he was in The Wizard of Oz.
Obviously.
He was one of the baby munchkins that is hatching out of the egg.
No kidding.
Oh, really?
I never knew that.
Is he visible in that shot? Because I know the shot you're talking about.
Oh, yeah.
Is he visible?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
To go back and look at that then.
Yeah.
That is so cool. Man, well, there's a little bit of a happier note here for to end this.
Yeah, he was a super, super fun guy to work with. And I know you guys aren't in L.A. He was also a kiddie show host here in L.A., Billy Barty Circus, they called it. And he would he was the MC, and he would show cartoons and stuff and have, you know, talk to kids.
Was that like a local TV show for kids? Yeah. Oh, that's so cool.
Yeah. I wonder if that's something that could be YouTubed, maybe, possibly.
Oh, maybe.
Yeah, I have to look for. I'll look that up after we do that.
Wow, Bill, it's. I have to throw this out too. You get so many fascinating stories about the films you've worked on. Just hearing the story of your connection to Land Before Time, mm-hmm. and you've worked on like Predator, which I would love to talk to you about your working relationship with John McTiernan and that whole mm-hmm. development. The Conan films, Red Sonja, First Blood. I love we could do like a spinoff interview with you where you just talk about the films you've worked on for Pop Culture Network. You know, yeah. It would be so cool to hear all these stories of these movies you worked on.
Next time I'll tell you the story of how I ruined the ending of Predator.
Oh,
that's a good cliffhanger. I like that. That's a good cliffhanger for the next one.
I gotta hear that
story. It had a great, great ending originally.
I look forward to that. Yeah, I like that. All right.
That's yep. awesome. Well, I guess we will wrap it up for our listeners here. Okay. And we thank Bill for joining us again. And we will have a third installment, which is cool. Fantastic to know.
Yeah. So I want to thank all the fans and listeners for showing up for this and watching this. It's a real treat for me to be able to share some of the stories with you guys. I still have really fond memories of that film. I'm very proud of Masters of the Universe. I think it turned out to be a nice movie.
And
junkies for this stuff. I just want to throw
a quick shout out, Tyler. In the YouTube chat room, Paul Rudman has been here for the whole show.
Yes.
And, I love Paul Rudman.
And Paul says, first of all, Joe, you have to do a Cosmicky custom.
Okay.
But second of all, he says, print him a book and he'll send you the check right away.
Okay. But
his final downer note though is that he is pretty sure Mattel would not play nice.
Oh,
yeah, I'm pretty sure that too from my past dealings with them. Yeah.
Well, I hope they would, but see, I'm telling you, you got fans out there. Like I said, that's whoever's watching. I mean, well, Paul watched it. He would want that book, and mm-hmm. it would just everybody would want this book. So we look forward to that, and can't wait to find out when you have more information on that for us.
I know a friend of mine who does. You know, a lot of current He-Man artwork for some of the mini comics for the new toy line. He's inspired by some of your artwork that he's thrown in nods to your Snake Mountain and some of the mini comics cool. that he's done.
Oh, man. I should pick up those comics and take a peek.
Oh yeah. I've got them and I just didn't notice it. And then after we posted your first interview, he posted the pictures, which I completely missed. And I'm like, yeah, your Skeletor throne room, he drew a nice little nod to it.
Oh, cool.
As well as I think the painting of Skeletor's the room with the pillars and Kark and his lineup of bodyguards, there's a nod to that in there. So he's a big fan of your artwork. So he's thrown in some nods just to help honor what you have done and what we could have got too. So.
Oh, that's cool. Well, thanks. Well, along those same lines. While I was designing Masters of the Universe, at my studio, I had two other artists working there. Richard Hescox, who was painting paperback covers, and Paul Chadwick. Paul Chadwick created the comic book character Concrete. And I would come in, you know, take breaks, come to the studio, and tell them the stories of all the stuff that was going on. Because it was a pretty wild set, and working for Canon Films is never dull. Well, if you pick up this series of Concrete stories that Paul did, he has Concrete working on a film called Rulers of the Omniverse. And he incorporated a whole bunch of my stories into that. And I appear there. He doesn't call me by name, but I'm the guy that looks like me wearing the Hawaiian shirt in the strip. It's really worth seeking out because Paul's a great comic book writer and artist. And it was really funny to me to see his version of Masters of the Universe being made in that comic book, but as Rulers of the Omniverse.
I like that.
I have to look that out. That's really cool.
Yeah.
All right. Well, yeah, we definitely look forward to having you back again for, well, of course, the cliffhanger with the Predator story, whatever other, pieces of art you might bring and show us for, you know, like exclusives. And of course, hearing all the other great stories that you have, because it seems like the stories you have are endless and could just keep going nonstop.
Yep. Yeah, you'll have to hear my favorite story, which is why the United States Air Force did not cooperate in the making of Invaders from Mars.
That sounds very interesting.
We got two cliffhangers. All right.
He's killing us here. Well, I guess we will wrap it up. And, Bill, I guess fans can go to your store and get in touch with you that way. Is that okay? Joe, anything else you want to say before we sign off here?
No, just pretty much, obviously, just a pleasure having you on. I mean, we look forward to it so much every time that you're going to join us. And we really appreciate you sharing all your stories, all this, you know, information with all the fans out there. And again, thank you. And yes, everybody go to williamstout.com, see what kind of stuff he has, because I know I'm going to be going there probably tonight.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Bill, for joining us again. We look forward to the third installment.
Okie dokie.
And guys, don't forget, you can leave a voicemail on our 24-hour voicemail line. It's area code 217-953-4025. Thanks for watching.